Welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Amina Berlin, and we're just going to go ahead and get started for getting the most out of Sysmon. There's our fancy disclaimer. And my favorite way to start a presentation. So I'm sure this is a version of a story that a lot of you have heard, and maybe a lot of you have actually experienced and have the stories to go along with it. So we'll call this company Pat's Grocery Store. They came to us, you know, not too long ago with a PS exec command running over their VPN, which is definitely way later in the attack process than you would really hope to detect an attack. And in this instance, there's no Sysmon installed, and we'll obviously through the next 40 minutes cover why that's important. All of their domain controllers have stopped sending Windows logs. They hadn't gotten us any of their endpoint logs, but it didn't matter because their endpoint client wasn't installed on their domain controllers anyway. The admin account that had run that psexec command over their VPN was a shared admin account with their VPN admin account, which also had domain admin across their entire environment. And lucky, the fact that we had Windows logs coming from the host that the psexec command landed on, otherwise we would have been completely blind to this entire attack the entire time. So it got through the VPN, pivoted, got to their domain controller, ran a psexec against another device that ended up sending us some logs. It's really nice, I think, that the threat actors offered a little bit of a discount for a fast turnaround. They did have to end up paying the ransom in this case, unfortunately, because they had also no working backups on those servers that were ransomed. Unfortunately, it's just one of those cases, and I'm sure a lot of you have seen this as well. You can't really lead a horse to water until its servers have been ransomed. I think that might be how the saying goes. So, as defenders, above and beyond all of the other roles that we play, so we have critical thinking, process creation, research, what are some of the main things that our focus is supposed to be? Defending against threats, right? Those three words, there are entire companies, compliance frameworks, conferences, you name it, built around those concepts. Prior to 2014, all antivirus products really just relied on MD5 hashes to detect bad things, right? They were just plain virus signatures that did the majority of the work. When now, the things on the internet pale into comparison as to what we've seen in 2014. Over the last 2 years even, before that, there's been a lot of shift to things in the cloud, but, last 2 years, everybody's been starting to work from home more than ever prior to that, right? So now we rely on what? Like advanced, next-gen, AI, boxes, or maybe we just wait until that server gets encrypted and you get a splash page. As these enterprise networks grow and hopefully mature, what we see is largely misconfigured endpoint security products. And I've been in the industry now for going on 15 years, and I'm sure I don't have to tell any of you that a lot of the mindset is just throwing money at a problem. I've sat in on a lot of these sessions, and it seems to be a recurring theme that you can just buy a new blinky box or a piece of software, and something's gonna magically fix the security in your environment without continuous thought, improvement, configuration, stuff like that. So a lot of times, you can do it correctly, but you have to have the time, the budget, the expertise, the staffing, and a lot of companies don't have that. So I'm here to talk about a really powerful tool that is free. So you don't really have to worry about the budget. Maybe a little bit on the time, but it's something that is going to really impact your environment as far as detections are concerned. So how can we make sure that your endpoint operating systems are giving you the biggest bang for your buck, especially when that buck is free? Sysmon's here to save the day, right? So I put the definition up here from Microsoft if anybody wants a refresher. It was released by Microsoft in 2014 with the Sysinternals suite of products, also a bunch of other great stuff in Sysinternals. And ever since then, you know, defenders and sysadmins have just kind of been perplexed as why all of this just isn't included in Windows logs by default. You can kind of consider Sysmon as like the Incredible Hulk version of Windows logs with, you know, what it does to increase the benefits of them. I guess it's tech, so you can consider it like the smart Hulk, the one from Avengers Endgame. So enterprise orgs have a lot on their plates, right? This came from the CSO security priority study. So 31% believe that their risk response efforts are underfunded, with 38% saying that they're gonna spend more on it. Now, what percent of those do you think have Sysmon already installed and configured as a part of their defense and detection response efforts? Going based on what we see in our average implementation, it is single-digit percentage, so much so that we've included it in all of our onboarding, right? So everybody always gets Sysmon, no matter if they keep us as a company or not. Like, they will go forward having Sysmon installed on all of their endpoints, and, you know, anybody else that gets their logs will be as happy as I am. Maybe, there we go. So I'm not one to read slides, but this one I think kind of bears repeating. So quick detection and response are critical to reporting the exact scope of a breach, figuring out what might have been compromised, and complying with the regulatory breach notification requirements. I was gonna get this as a tattoo, maybe instead of the live, laugh, log one that I, you know, have planned for a while, but, you know, we'll see. I don't know any good tattoo shops in San Francisco. So at any point, if you have an incident and have Sysmon already installed, configured, logging centrally, I can guarantee you, you're gonna be able to find your breach scope on Windows devices anyways. So this is a really good thing that we'll probably come back to. So I'm sure a lot of you have heard the phrase, assume you've been breached, when you're designing, you know, information security program. What is the first thing you think of when somebody tells you that? What am I selling you? Duh. good luck proving a negative. I'm not here to sell you anything, obviously, because this month's free. If you want me to sell you something, we have a booth downstairs. Feel free to find me sometime later today. So we're gonna move on to some Sysmon specifics real quick. So here are some of the specific benefits that Sysmon gives you in comparison to Windows standard logging. All the ones in bold, you do not get, no matter what you configure in Windows, hands down, those 10 different items. So when you are starting an investigation into a Windows host, you're either inserting yourself into something that's currently happening, like an IR engagement that's already happening, or maybe retroactively to kind of find some threats, and maybe some like detection ideas, right, when something bad has happened. And I can tell you after, you know, there's a couple of these too, while like DNS query, for example, right? While you can technically do that in Windows, has anybody ever tried to, on a standard Windows domain controller running DNS, try to enable DNS debug logging? It's not super easy, right? Comparatively speaking to just installing Sysmon and also getting all of these other added benefits. So now what do we do with this information? We can do some threat hunting. So one great method for threat hunting that I think a lot of us take for granted and that we do anyways is using standard deviation. You can use standard deviation to kind of weed out really common activity, and it's basically a baseline of activity. So in this example, just a general example, standard deviation, 85-ish% of it is in between the 1.5 standard deviation ranges. And you can calculate this a multitude of different ways, and I'll show you in the next couple slides an example of this. But you can weed out like things that normally happen in your environment, like people surfing the internet, them using your normal applications that are meant for business purposes. And then you can kind of look at the stuff in the smaller ranges to do some threat hunting. So I'm gonna blow this up, and for anybody that's colorblind, it's a little bit better than the next slide. this is an example of some Sysmon logs over time for all of our customers. The y-axis on the left you see is total destinations. So these are external, RFC 1918 IP addresses. And on the this is Sysmon process names accessing IP addresses out in the internet. And then the bottom is the Z score, which is that standard deviation score. And then this is, we started at 2 and went above. So, you know, prior to 2, there's a huge clump of data that we're just gonna ignore, and we're just gonna kind of look at these ones. So here's the data again, but we're gonna zoom in. Get it? Zoom in? Everybody awake? All right, so we have Zoom accessing 256 million IP addresses, Java, Chrome, more Java, Edge, GoToMeeting, RingCentral, email server. Then we have Notepad accessing 2 point some million IP addresses on the internet, thanks to our lab. We have a lot of servers that when you reboot them, Notepad just comes up 30 times. You can kind of use this. I mean, this is different, right, because it's across all of our customers. That's why the numbers are so large. But you can use this internal to any organization and kind of weed out your baseline activity to look at some of these like less common things. You do have to take it with a grain of salt, because imagine if there has been an attacker on your network for a while, their activity is gonna end up in your baseline activity. So you kind of have to, you know, use different forms to find that stuff. But this is one example. Another main detection strategy that we use is also free, called Vector. It's vector.io. And you can import different kinds of frameworks into this. Here you see MITRE, and we'll go a little bit deeper into a couple of these. They have a nice little heat map that you can use to map your detections to. And you know, they use the Atomic Red Team framework, so you can actually do some of the tests as well. If you don't have an internal purple or red team, this is a great place to start, because it actually gives you some guidance and you can map it to different stuff and kind of light it up as a heat map, which is nice. I'm a huge advocate also of detection testing. So who here, by a raise of hands, tests your detections on any kind of regular cadence, not counting your average, your normally scheduled pen test? Perfect. My favorite kind of people. All of the things that can go wrong when you're trying to detect stuff, right? You could have a service on an endpoint that stops running. You could have a local or network firewall rule that's like stops traffic. You could have, I see it a lot of times with firewalls, they'll upgrade their firmware, their log format changes, it breaks parsing, and it breaks your detections. So regular testing, not that you can test on every server everywhere against every threat, but you can kind of use this to prioritize, all right, I know that I want to test this SQL server or this web server or this group of endpoints because, you know, they deal with wire transfers. You can kind of prioritize it that way and put regular detection testing into whatever program you have running. So if we dive a little bit deeper, this is if we click on one of these things, right? So we're gonna do one of these tests. It takes you to a full page of red team and blue team details. Here it's discover domain trust with NTL test. Gives you the name, it gives you the T code for MITRE that it's attached to, it gives you a description. Here it like tells you it's been used by TrickBot, right, which is pretty helpful. And then it gives you some operator guidance. So again, if you don't have internal purple or red team, and you want to try and test your detection, just run that, right? And see if you can test that against, you know, your entire environment. And then they also have the blue team side. So the outcome and if it was detected or not, you know, you can add different stuff in here. Here, when we do it, we ran an entire Sysmon thing, right? Like a campaign, and mapped all of our Sysmon detections to this. And then when we would test it and try and find those bad things happening, we would put our queries in here so we can come back to them later if we needed to, and kind of use that as like a working notes as far as all of those detection testing. All right, now we've covered how we can use it for a little bit of threat hunting and detection creation. So let's go into some use cases. So you can extract process memory a multitude of different ways. So like everybody knows what Mimikatz is, right? You can also extract process memory and get hashes using comm services. So comm services was a DLL introduced into Windows XP. That is just like part of Windows, which is usually what we defend against, right? Is living off the LAN techniques. And there's a handful of detections that can find that stuff. You know, you can find Mimikatz running, you can find all this kind of stuff. And a lot of those can be considered like game-ending moves, right? So the attacker has the keys of the kingdom. Your security department's lives have gotten way harder than they've ever wanted to be. This isn't necessarily one of those, but it still should be considered a P1 threat because they have local hashes. They were able to use that command to dump those, and I'll show you in here. So you have run DLL32 with comm services. You run the mini dump command, the process ID, and then where you want to store those hashes at, and then you just say, you know, it's a full export. Just as a note, you can kind of see it down there, going through any of these, if it was like actual customer information, that's why it's blacked out. It's not anything that you need to know about. I'm gonna replay a lot of these in the lab so you can see the Windows event IDs that are generated normally and then with Sysmon. And then there's some related findings as well. So, you know, when you're detecting things, if you go out and create all of the Sysmon detections, that's great, but you still want to pay attention to other alerts that fire, right? So not only just on that device, but in the organization as a whole, and kind of correlate those and see if they, you know, have anything to do with each other. Here's a case where there's a handful of Sysmon detections with some plain Active Directory ones as well. So a lot of these are just Windows Event Viewer screenshots. Don't worry about zooming in on them. I will zoom in on the stuff that we talk about, and there's not too hard of a test at the end, so don't worry too much. So here's the use case one. On the left-hand side here, you see 4688 versus on the right, it's the the Sysmon Event ID 1. Just by sheer volume of information, you can see there's a difference, right? So we tend to want to use Sysmon Event ID 1 as they give you the hashes, they give you, on here is the RDP session that I RDP'd into the lab to run this command. It gives you a lot of information you can use on the parent process to correlate different actions. So just right away, it gives you an amazing amount of information compared to the plain Windows logs. And even by default, 4688 doesn't show up. So 4688, you have to configure in-group policy, you have to have process creation, as well as command line logging to have that show up even in your logs to begin with. In that last one, I blew this up a little bit. We recommend using the Sysmon modular configuration, and this is one of the reasons. It gives you a rule name and technique associated with that event that comes through. And you can kind of use those to, you know, map to different stuff. So the second screenshot here, that process creation, living off the land, is a part of the configuration in Sysmon Modular, that actually corresponds and adds that tag to the event ID. And then you can use that, so it says, you know, it's highlighted a little bit there in the middle, T1218002, that corresponds to the test and atomic red team. So you can kind of follow that train and, you know, look in vector or whatever and see that that's the test that you can run in ATR to get that to fire. So our use case one in summary, pretty easy. Comm services, dumping hashes. So you have a Windows event ID 1, and if your command or your parent command line looks like something like that, so comm services followed by mini dump, that's bad. Straight and simple. So now we can move on to some more in-depth detections and Sysmon event IDs. So this is one of those examples of that game-ending move, something that you definitely want to know as soon as possible. This is someone extracting all of the hashes from your Active Directory. So NTDS util has been used for years by admins, right? It's a very powerful tool, and it will help you like work with the Active Directory database that controls and holds all of the information like in the entire forest. So it's a very powerful tool, but it can also be used to extract and exfiltrate all of the information so somebody can start cracking your passwords. So by a raise of hands, has anyone ever had to either follow the Microsoft guidance on extracting someone from your, it's like, was it network? No, and I have a link for it in here somewhere. Network eviction process. For some reason, I couldn't think of eviction. Network eviction process or rebuild a forest from scratch. Oh, I got to talk to you guys afterwards. As much as I loved being sysadmin for a very, very long time, that sounds incredibly painful. and I would love to hear your stories on it. So here we see NTDS util being used. ACI NTDS sets NTDS as the active instance. IFM is installing for media, and then there you see a creating a full backup, and the QQ is just quitting those two previous commands. Oop, back one. Maybe, there we go. So with that use case, again, I'll zoom in on these. But on the left-hand side, what are these, 4799s? I covered, you know, event ID 4688 and 1 in the first one, so we'll kind of skip over that one. But here, you see, for the most part, just a whole bunch of 4799s, which is enumerating Active Directory. Happens all the time. That's just how Active Directory works. It provides group memberships. It provides all of this kind of stuff. Very hard to create a detection just based off of that. Depending on the environment, right? And then we'll take a little bit of a look into event ID 1 compared to the last one. So I'll zoom in on this one. And here you can see, where is it? On the top there is the command line. We have me, of course, and then the hashes of this. We have the parent process and the parent image, so it's running it from PowerShell. And I think ntdsutil.exe is the original file name on top there. Now with that attack, we have those other event IDs to look at as well. Here's the first place where we see event ID 10, which is a process being accessed. And this is another one that is not included in Windows, no matter what you configure, other than Sysmon, obviously. But by default. So this is a process accessing another process, and you'll see this a lot of times when it's like trying to access this memory and write to it. And then we also see event ID 13, and this populates when the command completed successfully. So you see this here, it's editing and modifying the registry. So use case two in detection, in summary. So we have Windows event ID 1, again. Process name is gonna be NTDS util, and your command or parent command line could be several things. In this example, it's just those quitting commands. It could also be that NTDS followed by IFM or any of those other, you know, pieces of that command. So again, this should not be run in your environment necessarily, but sometimes, you know, admins need to do it. But other than that, probably should be a great detection. So on to use case number three. Here, another priority one threat. ComSpec, as you see here on the bottom right, is an environment variable that calls the command line, all right? So not super common. You can see it in some like software that uses that, but not extremely common from what we've seen. You can't really see a whole lot of what's going on in this command, but you have ComSpec environment variable running a PowerShell, no profile, hidden encoded command. And you know, a lot of times that, you know, running encoded commands like that, I've seen kind of set off some false positives, but never in this exact order. And you know, it's amazing when you start to dive into logs like this, right? And you look at some of the attacker TTPs that they kind of go through, and then you realize there's a lot of production software that people use that also mimic attacker behavior. It's amazing at the amount of admin software that runs past the hash on the back end, very surprisingly. And kind of a little sidebar based on that. So when we were looking into data for examples for this talk, I came across this. So anytime you see like upper lowercase, this Unicode, you know, base 64, whatever, this was in event ID 1, you just think somebody's trying to perform some kind of obfuscation, right? Like that never is normal. So digging into that a little bit, it turns out it was Matt Graver's reflection method, which is an AMSI bypass. Terrible, right? Like you're like, oh my gosh, like somebody's using this bypass on this endpoint. It has to be owned. And then we saw like even more stuff, right? Like this PowerShell, this WMIC stuff, PowerShell invoke, like all of this kind of stuff running through these command lines. Turns out it was not an attacker. There's a very popular piece of endpoint software that for some reason just runs these through, I don't know if it's like an active test or a detection or anything like that, but it's just a piece of endpoint software that definitely uses open source code in somehow in their PowerShell logs. So back to the use case at hand, kind of. So that was that ComSpec, right? So it installs as a service on the endpoint. It's the first step, right? Normally it's some random service, but of course for this presentation, we went ahead and customized it. And so you have that sneaky way of calling SOCOM services followed by all of that, you know, that sketchy stuff. I've already showed you 1 and 13, so we'll just move into 8 and 10. Yeah, that's the sketchy stuff kind of just blown up there. So event ID 8, this is a create a remote thread detected. Most true positive injection attempts are gonna show up in 8 and 10. Again, yet have we seen a false positive with that injection attempt with ComSpec, but you never know. There's a lot of weird software out there, right? And then we have 10, which is a process being accessed. During the attack in the lab, we had a lot of 8s and 10s, right? Because that attack that was being run was trying to inject into all of the processes on that endpoint. But in this case, we only needed the one. Here, you can see it injecting into DLL. And, you know, the data here is encoded, so we can't really tell what's going on. And this was our test anyways. So in the beginning, that was the customer detection. So let's go back into looking what that encoded command was actually doing. So I took the encoded command from the PowerShell And a lot of times I've done this and it's just been like, something's updating a SCSI driver, or, you know, like there's this weird application that is running some arbitrary command and they just decided to encode it. In this case, it wasn't so. We actually decoded this base64 on the left-hand side. On the bottom, you see it again. Like, all right, well, maybe it's double encoded, right? Because it's like, I can't see it over there. Was it invoke object? Oh, yeah, new object from base64 string and another base64 string. Turns out it was a gzip compressed. So decompressed that, decoded it, and that turned into COBOL strike code. Very interesting. Another short sidebar. It's a good idea to take out the COBOL strike code of your presentation if you ever want anyone to review it. turns out that endpoint agents really don't like that. And then use case three in summary. So we want to look for event ID 12 or 13, and that command or parent command is only going to be comspec. Again, you may need to tune it in your environment if there's some weird application that uses comspec and somehow wants to open other processes or whatever, but this is a pretty good high fidelity detection for Sysmon. So now that you're a little bit more familiar with some of the event IDs that Sysmon has, let's throw it all together in a exchange compromise. So anybody remember proxy logon? It was back beginning of 2021. If you don't know about it, proxylogon.com has a great rundown of the vulnerability and exploit. It's basically on-prem exchange servers. You could access them over port 443, which is going to be open for, you know, Outlook web access. And without authenticating, you can impersonate the admin. We had a company come to us not too long ago that had received a notification about two MSI files that they hadn't run on their Exchange server. They're like, this looks a little sketchy. They didn't think it should be happening. And they were actually alerted to 11 different findings, so you'll see the next few slides happen in rapid succession. First one you see here is PowerShell being run on an Exchange server, injecting and spawning into DLL host. So like, yeah, we didn't do that, but who knows? Like, Exchange does weird things. Maybe it's, you know, maybe it's a false positive. And then we see a command being run of netgroup dom domain admin. So somebody on the Exchange server is trying to find all the domain admins in the environment. This happened at the exact same time as the other one. Again, maybe an admin doing admin things, not a great sign, especially when you have like a couple people working in that environment and like talking over their shoulders and trying to figure out, all right, was this you? And then here adds a little bit more suspect activity. Why would somebody be mounting the C drive of the domain controller to the Exchange server? Again, yeah, I've been there, right? Like, you're the only one doing stuff. You need a quick way of transferring files. You know, you just, you know, send it over the network and don't worry about that DMZ at all. So, you know, they're looking over their shoulders like, this is definitely not me. I did not mount this. What is happening? And then, like, their panic starts to set in. I know we talked a little bit about that PowerShell encoded commands, but here's another one that happens pretty often. Is using the .NET web client to download stuff. You can use this to bypass PowerShell execution policy, and it is seen all of the time in malicious software, just, you know, downloading random stuff from gulfcdn.com, not always, but like, you know, bit.ly or whatever other terrible websites, and you can just run that and it will download and execute in PowerShell. So, pretty easy. And then last but not least, we have that IIS web service that's seen in the Exchange Compromise IOCs. And that is calling another child process. So we see W3WPEXE spawning PowerShell or, you know, command line, whatever. But in this case, spawning PowerShell and running that .NET web client download. One example of the many detections in that example is that exchange compromise detection. So again, you have Windows Event ID 1. That parent process name is going to be that IIS service. So something random, maybe W3WPXE. And the process name is going to be running PowerShell or command line. So time to rip off your blindfold and, you know, maybe save yourself some capital expenditure. Some of the immediate steps you could probably take, you know, is seeing where the quality of your logging already is. Is it right for your environment? Is it on the right hosts? Can you detect against any of those attacks? You know, like performing some of that detection testing. Do you have a lack of logs? Do you even have a SIM, right? Do you have any kind of centralized logging? Definitely go back, scrutinize your logs. It's very, very important, especially on Windows hosts, one of the biggest attack surfaces there is. After you've gotten that information gathered, you know, you're going to want some kind of process of improvement plan. It could align with, you know, your department-specific goals. It could align with the goals of the entire organization, hopefully, maybe both. Maybe that process of improvement includes installing Sysmon. Maybe it's a change in your config. Maybe first steps into going and buying a SIM, which in that case, I probably should have thought of some kind of like referral program before I stood up here. And for those Sysmon installs that you may want to go out and do, which I know everybody's going to run home right away and be like, you know, I believe in Sysmon. Let's get this done because all of you seem very excited. it's called PowerShim. It's a PowerShell shim. Can be used on any SIM, right? Not just ours, but we do have the cute little logo. We were finding it very difficult and cumbersome to install Sysmon and NXLog across an environment because of how different endpoints are. You know, I'm sure you don't have just one operating system across your entire environment, and even if you do, those Windows environments have different things installed, right? One of the main problems is if you use NXLog Community Edition, it will silently fail if you do not have the correct event channel listed. So like say you have an event channel in your configuration file and it's not there on the Windows host, it's just gonna silently fail and you'll never get any logs. So trying to do that manually against like 100,000 endpoints is super difficult. So this is something that you can download. It will download and install Sysmon and NXLog and dynamically configure on the fly that NXLog configuration. So it's not gonna silently fail because it knows all of those event channels are already there. And you just have to point it to an IP address, whatever's gonna end up ingesting your logs for that host. You know, you can use it for whatever. You'll wanna choose a configuration. So I showed a couple times in those previous slides what are some of the advantages we get from Sysmon Modular. You know, you get that tie back to the MITRE ATT&CK framework. It gives you just this amazing amount of configuration options, right? So like a lot of people use Swift on security Sysmon config. It's fantastic. We just prefer to use the other one because you can, it's modular, right? So you can like comment out different sections, like you know, this configuration doesn't work on, you know, the majority of my endpoints, I'm just gonna use this one instead. So you can comment out like living off the LAN techniques, or you can comment out this or that. Like it's very comprehensive and updated fairly frequently, so. And then again, test your SIM. Highly, highly, highly recommend you have an active relationship with your SIM, whether it's a vendor or you have it internally or it's an MSS, it's in the cloud, whatever it is, test your detections. I did a webinar earlier this year. You can go and look at just for some real quick wins. There's like a password spraying PowerShell that you can, well, don't run it unless you have like permission. That would be bad. Or, you know, I'm not your boss, so whatever. but yeah, you can run that kind of stuff and see if it's going to be attacked. You know, a lot of people have a hard time detecting east-west traffic in their environment, right? There's a lot of flat networks out there. There's a lot of not much logging in between segments. So give that a try, right? Test them as much as you possibly can. And then last but definitely not least, give Vector and Red Canary a try. It's a really, really good way to map a framework to your detection testing and creation. So in summary, the threats that we defenders are up against are never gonna decrease. You know, attackers are constantly finding new ways to break into an environment, and you know, we've seen that Sysmon not only can be used for detection creation and enhancing those logs, but you can also use it for that threat hunting if you want. And you know, with a variety of configuration options that you have and a good SIM, it can provide you a lot of information and give you so much visibility into your Windows environment. So I'd like to thank my team at Blumira. They're absolutely fantastic. And all of you for coming in today. I really appreciate it. And hope you learned something helpful about Sysmon today. So if you have any questions, feel free to come up to the mic or catch me outside.
Hello. Go on.
Just bend down. That's cool.
When your SIEM is on-prem and you say you want to put Sysmon on all the endpoints, especially now with everybody working remote, and when you have lots of endpoints that barely connect VPN or at all, is there like something in Sysmon that can either cache and then send or whatever? Like, how do you deal with this reality?
Sure. Actually, a problem that's currently in process, my boss is working on, and endpoint log shipping is difficult, especially when you have so many people working from home or wherever, right? Like if you have your laptop here, how's that Sysmon going to get to your on-prem whatever ingestion? I can't give you the exact answer right now, but it's something that's currently being worked on. There are products out there that do it that you can pay for, but I don't want to be up here like, you know, selling a bunch of other products. But.
Well, the only way is if you have your SIM on the cloud. And
correct. Yep.
Yeah, but yep. If you're scared and you keep stuff on-prem, then you're kind of...
Yes, as far as I know, yeah.
All right.
Yep. Correct. Can you go to the mic? Yeah, thank you.
Hi, thank you for sharing. I have Sysmon installed on about 50 to 100 hosts in my organization.
Yeah.
The problem I'm facing now is the logs, storage of the logs. So Sysmon is free, but not the infrastructure and the storage that comes with it.
Correct.
So how does one overcome, and how much should I store the logs for?
Yeah. So it depends on your SIM too, right? Depends on your licensing, depends on your infrastructure, right? Like, I mean, storage can be expensive depending on where you're storing them at. Prioritizing logs and using that Sysmon modular config, you can do, right? So you can, say you only want to do event ID 1 as opposed to all of your Sysmon logs, right? You can kind of pare it down with that. And, you know, if it's a bigger attack surface in your servers, do that instead, right? You don't necessarily, with the money and the infrastructure, can't always do every single endpoint device, sadly, because, you know, a lot of licensing is expensive, but you can also, you know, not to be a huge sales pitch, but come find me, because we don't charge based on amount. All right, thank you everybody so much. I appreciate it.